Hello everyone, and welcome to this wonderful lecture session from the horror program at the University of the Underground. We are the students and professors and director of the program, Aji Ains here, and Aji is a critical is leading a critical exploration into illicit societal fears and human passion for horror, and we will be investigating institutions and popular culture through the lens of the horror genre in dramaturgy, film, costume making, and more. The University of the Underground is a free, pluralistic, and transnational university founded in 2017 and birthed in the basements of nightlife venues. It's a non-profit and registered charity, so if you want to donate, please visit universityoftheunderground.org website, and you can find other exciting program times and events or the Instagram page online. Giving word to Aji, that's going to introduce our professor, Aliki Katriou, if I got the name, kind of. Thanks, Aji.
Thank you, Ludvika. Great. Yes, hello. I'm super excited to be introducing Aliki Katriou. So she's going to be running a workshop called Screaming for Vengeance. Aliki is a human with a love for singing in all its varieties, especially metal. She's has an extensive knowledge of classical technique, contemporary styles, and extreme vocals. So since 2013, she's been teaching voice to metalheads around the globe, from beginners to touring artists and voice teachers. Aliki is the lyricist and vocalist for her own band, Eight Lives Down, and the vocalist and the critically acclaimed Greek metal project, Desolate Plains. So Aliki, over to you. Thank you for joining us.
Hello, human beings. All right, so I'm going to throw you straight into my weird slides and let's talk metal. Let me know if you can see this.
Perfect, yeah.
Woo! All right, here we go. So, nice and boring for you, just running through what you just heard. I am a metalhead, which is a human being who listens to metal music. I sing in a metal band and I teach singing to metalheads primarily. I sing for my band, Eight Lives Down. We're an extreme metal band, which is a lot of fun. Let's not go into what that means necessarily. A lot of growling and screaming is a good start for you. I also sing for Desolate Plains and Tattered Pages, which are both studio projects.
Yay!
So, heavy metal is a music-oriented subculture. It is typically white and male-dominated, so if you happen to go to a metal gig, you will most likely be the only female there, or maybe if you're female, there might be one other female in the room, and you'll be like, ah, ha, I see you, you see me, good times. But yeah, the guitarist is the most significant member of the band. So if, let's say, we had the whole band on stage and we only had one spotlight, that spotlight would go on the guitarist, no questions asked. It would never go on the vocalist or anyone else. So it's not like pop music, not vocal centric. A couple of words that would easily characterize heavy metal would be extreme, aggressive, powerful, epic, masculine, and dynamic. The sound is characterized by distorted guitars, very complex drumming, extended vocal techniques, so sounding like monsters and gurgling, dying people, and an extremely loud volume. Never, ever, ever go anywhere near a metal gig without hearing protection. You'll get tinnitus. Just don't do it. So yeah. Micro warning for you. Heavy metal is a beautiful, beautiful genre of music, but band names and lyrics tend to be a little bit gross. The themes and the imagery very often are disgusting. Hi. Sanctity of life is not a given at all. So you might get a lot of songs about mutilating and murdering various people. And it's all good. Yay! So, in this moment, two ideas for you. The first thing is a slight parenthesis. Because heavy metal is a music-oriented subculture, which tends to be odd because other subcultures like punk, goth, a lot of rock, actually do have political associations to them or lifestyle associations. So like there's a very strong association between punk and politics, rock and drug use and stuff like that. Metal doesn't have any of those associations attached to it. When you say metal, you're just talking music. And you could be anyone, any political belief, any background, any group, and no one will blink if you enter the room, as long as you like metal. That's like the only gatekeeping thing. So it's a really, really nice open space, but it's kind of chaotic and has no laws, if you will. So the negative side of that is at any given moment, you could be standing next to your local neo-Nazi, next to your local extremist, and no one is going to say anything. That person is allowed to be in that space. Everyone is allowed to be in that space. So various problems can arise from this. Another thing that we're just going to say in passing is that a couple of bands use metal as a wonderful, wonderful vehicle to kind of promote their own agenda, be it far right stuff, burn down the churches, all that kind of beautiful stuff, whatever it is that they want to promote, because whatever you want to promote is allowed. It's just your opinion. That. Yay! Woohoo! Now, giving you a couple of examples of what metal sounds like, just so you've got a little bit of a landscape, we're going to start with heavy metal, which is kind of the thing that originated in the late 70s, let's say, to be kind of accurate, and 80s. And that would sound something like this. Tell me if you can hear this. It's not working. Beautiful. Let me do that again and let me share with sound, because we all know I probably didn't. Can you hear it now? So that is bog standard metal, old school metal, it would be considered nowadays. Heavy metal spawned power metal, which has micro differences, but sounds something like this. So that would be one branch. So you've got the heavy metal into power metal and other micro subgenres, but these are the two main ones. And the other branch is thrash metal, which is going to lead to all this lovely, gory, disgusting stuff, which is the stuff that we care about. Yay! Or that we care about a little bit more, because all of metal is a little bit horror-based. Thrash metal, I'm actually going to let you listen to this example for a bit longer than the rest, because it gives you a really good sense of what the music sounds like. We'll be right back. example is that it gives you a really, really strong sense of the fact that hopefully after hearing that, you are probably going to sing the guitar riffs, not what the vocalist did. What the vocalist did borders on not having a melody to it. Yay! So guitar is everything. Death metal is when the vocalist starts getting noisier and more grunty-like and monster-like. Sounds something like this. You will soon come with me to die. Find that death is not me. Black metal is where you're going to find any, well, most of your neo-Nazi dudes hanging out trying to pretend that they're black metal, but that's where you'd find them if you did. Very based in folk music. Here you go. Kind of nice and melodic if you actually like it. Right, and doom metal, which is a slower version of these, and basically is an excuse for me to let you listen to Primitive Man, which is an awesome band, but listen to this. Say that's a great example of the aesthetic. Like, you play that to any metalhead, they'll be like, oh, that's so beautiful. But yeah, that. And just one last micro detail for you, which is something that you might like from the visuals. This is corpse paint. So if you want to know what that is and how to find it online, just Google corpse paint, which is what the black metal guys do when they go live. A lot of it includes a lot of blood around the mouth and eyes, but this is just such a great example that I'm like, look at Karachangren. So yeah, haha. And now we jump into the deep end. Hi! Woo! Any questions or weirdness about metal? Anything you need to know?
Could I ask something? I'm interested because you were sort of saying that it's, and we spoke about this last time we spoke briefly, that like it's sort of metal's inclusive in a way that it will invite everyone. But then that being said, like you end up being with people who might have very different political beliefs than you. Yes. Is the idea that like when you're engaging with metal, you don't share those, but like, or yeah, I'm wondering how that, what happens, like,
so
what happens?
Usually nothing happens. You can kind of share anything and everything, and the most likely thing is someone will go, okay, and move on and not care about what you just said about your creepy beliefs. The only time when they might get a little bit angsty is if you're very religious and you're very like pro-Christianity, then they might get a little bit iffy. Like, I would say that's the primary thing that metalheads tend not to like. But even then, they'll just be like, don't talk to that person. Keith Carn Harris wrote a book on extreme metal, And in that, he mentions about the fact that metal is reflexive and not reflexive at the same time. So it's really, really rigid and really stuck in its ways. And that rigidity is associated with strength. So even if you have a clash of opinions and someone is saying something that you agree with, in that moment, the code of conduct would be to stick to your guns and kind of have a bit of a weird Schopenhauer-esque argument, which is so pointless. But there is that. I would say the main thing that metalheads value and the main thing that they want is agency and independence. So as long as you're not following anyone else's ideas, as long as, you know, you're very religious because you chose that and there are reasons and there's a method and you have blah, 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 whatever internal reasoning, they respect that. If your reasoning is, my parents are religious, no, that's not going to go down well. So as long as you kind of chose it, that's great. But that also creates a little bit of a safety barrier because everyone is really thinking of themselves as very, very separate units. And so it kind of doesn't matter that local scary person is in the space.
Yeah. No, thank you. It's really interesting that this, there are behavioral similarities of people in the group. So it's interesting to talk about like how it works as a collective if people are very different from one another. That's so, yeah, thank you.
Any other questions before I dive in and get you all to start yelling and wailing? This is gonna be fun. All right, so just putting this out there, metal music is extreme. Metalheads are often extreme human beings, and the vocals are extreme. So what we're gonna be doing is gonna be kind of extreme. You might experience pain. It's okay. As long as you don't go around doing this for like 6 hours nonstop, it's all fine. Oh. If you experience acute pain, just lift your hand and be like, I'm dying here.
That'll be good.
All right, we're gonna focus on three primary sounds.
We're gonna do little vomiting sounds, which is gonna be beautiful.
We're gonna do Mongolian throat singing sounds, and we're gonna do weird sighing noises. So, first thing, let's get started on the vomiting sounds. Hi. I don't want you to do a real vomit. So when you actually throw up, your abdominal muscles are going to engage, all your core musculature is going to be involved, and your tongue is going to pull down really strongly in order to create space for whatever it is to exit your oropharynx. The primary thing that I want you to avoid is your tongue pulling down, because that you can kind of induce your own gag reflex in yourself. So let's not do that, maybe. So I'm going to get you all to stick your tongues out, and we're going to go for a really quiet noise, and you're going to do like a cat coughing up a hairball. So that kind of noise. See if you can get that going.
Hi.
Should we be on mute or not?
Whatever you prefer. I would say for your vomity sounds, you can stay muted. So just give yourself really light noises. You would use that if you were doing a lovely concept album. You had background noise and you were like, this is the way I'm going to introduce myself. That's how I'm going to start the song. It's going to be beautiful. Probably the most popular example of this, I don't think that people realize it, but probably the most popular example of this is Disturbed, Down With The Sickness, which for whatever reason, I don't have an audio sample of, with me, which is really annoying. But right at the beginning of the song, he'll do the first noise. So he'll do his ah, and then he'll go into ah, and he'll go into vomiting sounds. And you're like, yes.
Hi.
Any questions about your weird little micro vomit sounds so far?
Is it better to stand up or sit? I mean, I'm sitting down. Is it?
Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. It's not classical singing. It's not classical singing, and realistically, you're going to be on stage and you're going to be headbanging. You're never going to be upright and like, oh, look at me, I'm so proper. You'll be flailing all over the place.
Oh, and I wanted to ask you, this sound is actually inspired by vomiting, or is it,
Yeah.
So it was an inspiration.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Does it benefit you to have your, because you were saying don't put your tongue far back, does it, mm-hmm. like, do you need it really out, or just a little bit out?
It doesn't need to be really out. But for a lot of people, it just kicks in as a reflex. To begin with, having it fully out is probably going to give you better results. And then you can have it fully in, just like, and it all works well. But I would argue if you watch any metal singer, at some point during the live gig, they're going to stick their tongue out. They all will. They're just like, yeah. But then again, they're always making faces.
Now, let's go into the Mongolian noises.
And just kind of rotate in a weird circular way, so we're dipping into each thing slightly. If I get everyone here to clear your throats, so you're literally looking for an sound, loud and violent and strong. Try that for me.
All right.
So, if this is your larynx, hi. It's like the person with random larynxes lying around. If this is your larynx and this is facing the same direction that you're facing, so front of your face is here, back of your head is here. You've got your epiglottis at the top, your tongue starts along this bone, along the hyoid bone, and extends outwards. Your epiglottis is this flappy thing, moves all the way down whenever you swallow food, so that nothing is going into your lungs. That's your first line of defense. So epiglottis covering your vocal folds, making sure that all the food and saliva and water and everything goes into your esophagus rather than your larynx. When your epiglottis fails, your false vocal folds take over. So the blue line is your true vocal folds. That's what you use when you speak. And the red line above that is your false vocal folds, which is a second set of vocal folds in your larynx. Because it is above, it's gonna sound lower. High, which might be a little bit counterintuitive, but what you're thinking of is length of a tube. So the longer the tube, the lower the sound. And if you want to hear a really, really, really low sound, get on YouTube and search for a koala being aggressive. Because they have a second set of vocal folds that is almost located inside their nose. And it is the lowest thing you've ever heard. It's awesome. So yeah, highly recommend the koalas trying to kill each other. So we are trying to engage these things. Assume a chicken wing is coming down and you are choking. That is the noise of your false vocal folds. You want it to be violent and you want it to be strong, because if you do a polite dinner party throat clearing, meaning if you go you might engage your retinoids instead of your false vocal folds, which is a separate thing that can knock and make weird sounds. but isn't used for the massive monster sounds. So, strong throat clearing of death is what we're going for. And then you try to sustain it. So if you've got, you try to go, and you stay on that noise of clearing your throat. And to begin with, it can sound diffused and weird and like, and chaotic. Let that happen. But give that a go. See if you can find that. So you're trying to go,
I feel like I sound a bit like Kermit the Frog at the moment.
I love that you're sounding like Kermit the Frog. If you sound like Kermit the Frog, there's a possibility that you're jiggling your epiglottis. Hi, there are many things that can jiggle in our bodies. Try, this is going to sound really weird, but take the tip of your tongue, jam it at the bottom of the root of your bottom teeth and stick the middle of your tongue out. So your tongue is in a eh. And try doing it with your tongue in that position. That's the one. And the only thing you need to do is actually make it louder. There you are.
It's very satisfying in a strange way. I don't know if anyone else wants to share their results.
So the engagement of your false vocal folds is going to directly parallel the engagement of your true vocal folds. So if you want more false vocal fold engagement, you go louder on your vocal folds. So you just make your own voice louder and you'll get more false fold. Reason being very simple, they belong to the same muscle, actually. So it's a little bit like your abdominal muscle, with your vocal folds being your lower ab, your false folds being your upper ab. You can kind of pretend that you've isolated them, but they're not isolated. They like to work together. Any questions so far? Is anyone dying of pain? Oh!
Emily didn't look that sure then. Is it hurting, Emily?
No, it's just I have a bit of a cold, like, so it's a bit like it's just like really harsh, but I'm doing my best, like, don't worry.
Great.
If you play around with this, you might find that it really, really dries out the area. This is because the bottom of your false vocal folds, you'll especially feel it if you're ill, the bottom of your false vocal folds are basically covered with sacs that generate mucus, and they drip that mucus onto your vocal folds. So the secondary biological function of your false vocal folds, apart from clearing your throat, is to keep your vocal folds hydrated. So then when you start knocking them together, that hydration, instead of going onto your vocal folds, goes upwards and it's like, ah, pointless. And it can feel like you're really, really just drying out the area massively. Your body gets used to it, said the local weird metalhead.
And then,
let's bring on a weird sigh. So, here's what I want you to do. I want you to find a sigh that is a little bit like a grunt, so to speak. So a little bit like an ugh, that type of noise. So just annoyed human being. Find that noise for me, and we'll do this in three steps. So find your ugh.
Grr.
And now, let's go for a general weird pitch. I'm going to give you this as an abstract target. I'm not deeply concerned about you pitching that correctly. What I am concerned about is that you are not in your speaking voice. So you're not going, but you're here. Hi, Mickey Mouse voice. This is what we want. The weird lady voice, make fun of the operatic ladies. Or more accurate would be that weird noise that men tend to make when they pretend that they're speaking like women. Like that weird noise that no woman has ever made when speaking. That one. That's what we're going for. So, what a male would call a lady voice. Let's go there. And I want you to start on an ooh. You start up there and then you sigh down. So you're going, ooh. Do that for me. How's that going? Are we happy?
It's very funny watching everyone do it without hearing them do it, because there's great facial expressions going on, I think.
It's always awesome and fun. Now here is your third step. Let's add a micro intermediate step before we get to your third step. Do that one more time and sustain that low kind of sigh noise for like two or three beats. So if you've just been going, ooh, ooh, give yourself, ooh, stay on it for a little bit. Do that for me. And here's your third step, which is where I expect to see the glazed eyes and everyone being like, what? How did we get there? Do the following. You're going to do exactly what you just did, only that you're going to add one detail at the end, which is that you're going to start high up, you're going to sigh down, and then you're going to go back up to where you started on the same noise. So your target is actually this. Your target is to pull that sigh up in pitch. Hi. Give it a go. See if you can do it.
I don't know if I'm doing the right thing.
Do it. Give it a go.
Ooh,
I would say you can go into a lazier sigh, so open everything even more. With more air passing through the system, and then climb that up.
Ooh,
And your challenge will be flipping from your speaking voice all the way back into your head voice, which muscularly won't want to happen.
Yay!
Does anyone else want to show their how they're getting on?
Yeah, I have no idea if I'm doing it right.
I love it. Go for it.
Okay. Oh, but is it the one that goes up high? That okay.
Yeah.
That was a great end.
Yes, make it louder.
Louder.
Yeah, like go louder on your vocal folds. For a lot of distortions, especially when you're first learning how to do things, louder is mechanically easier to do and hurts less. Very often. And then you try it louder and you die of pain and I'm like, whoops. But try it out though, like make it louder.
Okay, I'm sorry for you guys. Okay. Oh.
Hi.
Oh my god.
Oh, I love that.
Was that better?
That was better. And if we were in a one-to-one lesson together, I would get you to involve more of your voice. So more of your true vocal folds.
Like my speaking voice.
Uh-huh. Hi. So you've got both noises going on at the same time, which is going to make it even louder and even more gross sounding.
Is it kind of like playing a kazoo almost?
Yeah.
Right. So you're letting air go through, but you're also creating a noise.
Yes.
Right. I've never had to operate. It's interesting to like visualize these two lines and have to.
Yeah. And then your other kind of variation of that would be, instead of going down and back up, you go on that woo and you try and sigh on that pitch. So if you've got woo, you're trying to go without dropping. Try that. So generally, again, reminder, your false vocal folds belong to the same muscle as your true vocal folds. And so when they engage, what wants to happen muscularly is the pitch wants to go down. And so you're trying to disconnect a bit of a physiological reflex that happens in your body. And that's really weird and difficult to do.
Yay!
But it's the target of most metalheads. All these things build up into the same kind of thing. So the Mongolian throat singing tone that we were doing, which is your the only difference between Mongolian throat singing and metal singing is the amount of compression. Compression being the proximity of the vocal folds towards the midline of the body, so how much they're squeezing together. So if in your speaking voice you've got eh, and that would be a compressed sound, you could make it breathy in order to decompress the vocal folds. So it'd be eh. And as a metal singer, you want to learn to do that with your vocal folds and your false vocal folds. So you want to be able to go that layer of control is what these lovely human beings are trying to achieve for their art form.
Yay.
So that it sounds like it lacks a harmonic pitch. It doesn't in reality. Your vocal folds are still singing underneath all that noise, and there is a pitch to it, and you can learn to hear the pitch, but you're trying to make it as inharmonic and as close to noise as possible.
Ta-da!
Again, general rule of thumb, if you are singing metal and your neighbors are knocking on your door saying, "It's beautiful, please do more of that," you're probably doing it wrong. Your neighbors should be calling the police. Your neighbors should be saying, "Oh, we can't stand that noise." Should be saying, "This is awful. Why would you want to do this in life? This is a disgusting sound." That's the target.
Yay!
Questions?
I have lots of questions all the time, so I'm going to jump in. When you do it, I can hear the difference, but obviously it's like learning a sport, isn't it? Like I couldn't even know whether I was doing the right thing. But also, I'm wondering, how do people evaluate when they've made a better sound? Like, is it like, oh, that sounds better for what I'm trying to write? Or is it like, it feels better? Or, yeah.
I would say it does depend. I would say the primary thing that most people use is the evaluation of it sounds better for what I'm trying to write, for the art that I'm trying to make and what I'm trying to express. In terms of doing it in a good, sustainable way, it feels better is the most important aspect. You want it to feel like nothing, kind of like you were speaking. And I would say common words that people will use, they're looking for it usually to sound powerful. They want it to sound more powerful. Sometimes if it's like the vomiting sounds, etc., disgusting becomes the key word. But think toilet flushing is a good rule of thumb. Think of a toilet flushing or a garbage disposal machine. The closer you can sound to something that doesn't sound human, that's all you care about. Right. You just don't want to sound like a person.
Right. Thank you. Any other questions?
Hey, do you mind like trying just to like sing a bit of metal? Maybe, I don't know, like just to kind of contextualize that sound to listen how it can sound like in a wider.
Yeah.
I'm just interested to hear because I think it's quite cool.
Hi, let's see. Let's pick a random song. Okay, I'm gonna pull up the lyrics of Anal Nathrak and Darkenment, which might not be your best example ever because there are a lot of effects on his vocals, but I'm just gonna do it with pretty straight standard tone. Here we go. Let me know. He moves away from the microphone. Hi. So in context, it would be something down the lines of hi, internal music playing. I'm not listening to anything. As one we marched alone into nauseating neglect. Like all good swine, we deserve our fate. Marching into oblivion, split by the end, we'll beg. And then we're going to a clean chorus. Would it be something like that?
Awesome. Very nice.
Thank you, thank you. It's a lot of fun.
And I had a question, does it have to be live or can you also, like, if you edit your voice, then you can make even more stranger sounds, but where is the limit? Like, does it has to be human? Also, you were talking about a koala before. So are you sometimes also using sounds that are coming not from human, or is it possible to edit, or does it has to stay always live and as a performance?
So metal has a very, very, very strong live aesthetic. I think there are two kind of components to it. The first thing is that you're trying, because it's extreme, you're trying to find the limits of what is physically possible. And everyone on stage is kind of dying. At all times, we're all like, oh my god, yay, and that's part of the fun of it. And then the other part is that metal has a very, 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 very strong Oh, it's so weird. People call it an elitist streak when they don't like it. But what it has is it borrows classical aesthetics and sensibility a lot, and then just transfers it onto what they're doing. So there's this whole idea of, well, you know, like a human can sing operatically and can sing over an entire orchestra and it's amazing, and a human can also make those monster sounds, and if you incorporate anything digital, you're not really doing anything amazing in a way. So there's this really old school kind of aesthetic to it and sensibility.
Okay, nice. Thanks.
It's especially in the vocals. There are some people who think that the vocals are the only thing that remain a little bit less processed. So the vocals are like your only link to humanity in the context of metal, because everything is distorted, everything is electronic, everything is going at max volume. But yeah, hi. I don't know if that answers your question.
Yeah, it answers. Thank you. So yeah, it's about the limit of the human body. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I would say if you do something digitally, you're very likely to get to generate a feeling that whatever's happening is slightly uncanny. So you can get this really weird, like the valley of the uncanny, you know, like seeing a human doll and you're like, and there's this discomfort. But if you really, really, really push the human body to make horrifying sounds, that's when you really freak out the audience and freak out people, because they're like, this shouldn't be happening. You shouldn't be making that noise. It's like, yes, isn't it great? So there's that element to it.
But so you have to be present to really believe in this song. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I was actually gonna ask about that, about the audience and the relationship that the metal performance has, like, because what you're saying makes me think that one of the parts that make like metal so horrific is that it's actually literally involving parts of the body that are not usually used to produce sound. So it's like it's uncanny from the beginning, like from how the sounds are produced. So I was wondering, like what kind of situation does metal want to generate? Like, does it involve like participation in, like, you know, it's very different being at a metal concert than listening to metal in my headphones while I am in a bus and I can't sing along. So it's like the kind of aura it's going to be in me. What's like the difference in between maybe the ritualistic moment of the concert and listening to metal on your own, on the street or in your house, and the kind of different types of, you know, reaction and involvement I can have with the music.
So metal, if you're listening to it alone, the standard kind of ritual within quotation marks is metalheads typically consume music in albums. So they don't listen to single tracks. You would listen to the entire album from beginning to end, and you would sit with it. Even if you hated it, you'd be like, so there's this weird, like, prolonged suffering or prolonged enjoyment, but there's something about it that moves more slowly than other musical genres in the way that you interact with it. In a metal concert, it really depends on the band, because different bands will have slightly different goals. A really, really good example of a band that is an like the whole performance from beginning to end is a ritual, is a band called Batushka, with an H. So Batushka, a black metal band, and they released, so the first album that they released was called Liturgia, which is the Orthodox Christian whatever the procedure thing in church. Hi, I don't know my church terms in English. I'm very Greek. but, and so what will happen is they'll set up the stage and the entire stage will be a backdrop, like an ecclesiastical backdrop. So they'll literally recreate a church. And then once you get a little bit of atmosphere going, people will come out with the candles and everything and set that up and ritualistically like light them, and all the figures are hooded and everything, and then the singer comes out, stands there like a potato, does not move, is static the entire time, is literally just imitating a priest, has a book in front of him, and all the backing vocalists, like everyone in the band, have masks on that are defaced Christian icons. So that would be an example of a very ritualistic metal band. Wotane are another really good example, who are an openly satanic black metal band, and they will do like, they'll have animal hides and blood dripping behind them, like real animal hides. They'll have carcasses. They'll have blood stuff, they'll randomly do certain rituals in the middle of the show, they might cut themselves, things like that. So there is that, but the massive tendency is for that to exist in black metal as a subgenre. The rest of the genres, what I would say is primarily happening is you are going out there in order to create a feeling of incredible energy and power. It's very power centric. It's very power fixated. And then the audience can choose to either disagree with how you're displaying that power, which is a very common problem that women run into in metal. If you're a woman on stage, a lot of the male audience will just be like, no. Like, you're not doing this well enough. Like, you need to give me way more than what you're giving me for me to have a suspension of disbelief and think, yeah, you're the most powerful thing in the room right now. So they can disagree with it. They can... they can be in awe of it, or they can live it vicariously. I would say ideally you want them to vicariously live it, but this is a little bit of a personal belief. Like, I would say metal is a safe space, a safe public space for men. It is a place where men can go to feel like for once in their life they are men and they are the alpha male, because most men will not have that experience. In their lives, they'll see it in a lot of weird ways, but they won't get that, and you get mosh pits and all the flailing and the hitting each other and the walls of death and crashing into each other. We're like, like Viking mode, but it's that you just want everyone to feel like a Viking, and you just want all these men to just be really, really, really happy for like 30 minutes, really happy that they're men. And be like, yay, I'm also a dude. Like, that's what you want to give them, is what I would say. I don't know how many dudes would agree with that, but.
Yay.
I have a question. Can I ask?
Yeah.
So you spoke briefly about how, just now, about how you have to do more as a woman to prove that you have power in those spaces. And then you also mentioned that there are people with different points of view. Like, you said that there are some metal categories where there are like Nazis and things like that. But you also said that it's a space that is inclusive towards everyone. So would you say it's inclusive but not necessarily safe?
I would say it is safe, not necessarily inclusive, if okay. you are a female.
But what if you are...
else? If okay. you're anything else,
you're
like you.
Okay.
There are some
even if you're like, so if you're a female or so if you're male, you're fine. Even if you're a person of color.
Yeah. 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 There are some really, really fun, interviews that Dina Weinstein conducted with metalheads in the 80s and early 90s. She released her book, I think it's called Heavy Metal, in 2000? Is it 2000 or is it 2001? Who knows? hi. But she found that consistently, metalheads were more likely to be accepting of men of color. And there were more men of color in bands during 80s and 90s than there were women.
Just a follow-up question, what about gender non-conforming people or femmes that are not necessarily women but or like feminine men or, you know, people in between?
So I would say it depends on how you behave and how you dress. Metalheads tend to have a kind of dress code of a blob. I look like a sack of potatoes. Like that's kind of the code. They tend to wear clothes that you wouldn't notice. Like the most indifferent trousers that you're like, where did you, how do you purchase something so indifferent? And band t-shirts. So here's a weird thought for you. Metal loves power and metal loves control and dominance. And all of that kind of stuff. As a result, metal dislikes sexuality. Sexuality is a conversation. It's a communication between two people. Metal doesn't want this. Metal is like me, meh. And so when you bring sexuality into the room, metalheads will become very defensive, very aggressive. They don't like that. And this is also the problem that women run into, is that a lot of women will conform to societal norms and dress codes. And they're like, oh, I need to wear dresses. Oh, I need to wear high heels. Oh, I need to have makeup on. All these are manifestations of sexuality. And so all the dudes in the audience are like, ah, and they get really uncomfortable about that. They don't want that. So I would say if you are a non-conforming, fluid, binary blob, no problems. If you are a homosexual blob, no problems. If you are male or female or anything that is openly exhibiting an expression of sexuality, not the best idea with this crowd. Hi.
I'm so sorry, everyone, but I might have to cut this. We're getting into really interesting territory, and I think that this is such an interesting conversation to be had. But unfortunately, we've run out of time, and we've been going for a really long time today. So I really hope that perhaps these are questions that the students might be able to contact you about if you're willing to talk about things later. That would be wonderful. But for now, thank you so much for your time. Thank you. I've enjoyed doing a bit of screaming and understanding this group of people more. really appreciated your time. Thank you so much to everyone. See you later.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.